Hello everyone, welcome to this session on osteology of the head and neck. In this session we'll be revising all the bones of the head and neck region. Okay, so how many bones are there in the head and neck region? So here is the list. In all there are 36 bones in the head and neck region. 22 bones are formed by the skull, of which 8 are cranial and 14 are facial. We'll see the names of each of the bones subsequently. And there are 6 ear ossicles and 7 cervical vertebrae and 1 hyoid bone. Okay, so all these bones will be covering in this particular session. Okay, so let's start with the skull first. While studying skull, we should be knowing about various terms which are used while describing the skull. There are many terms which at times students get confused, so I have listed down all the terms. When we speak about skull, skull means the entire thing which is seen. Here, whatever is seen in the image, this is skull. And what is cranium? When the mandible is removed from the skull, that the remaining portion is referred to as cranium. Okay. Then what is calvaria? Calvaria, skull vault and skull cap. Okay. These three names are synonymous. This refers to the upper part of the cranium. Okay. Then basicranium, skull base and cranial base. These three terms are synonymous. Okay, this refers to the basal part of the cranium. So these are various terms which you should be knowing. Okay, these three terms are synonymous: basic cranium, skull base and cranial base. These three terms are synonymous: calvaria, skull cap and skull vault. Skull is the entire thing, and when the mandible is removed, then the specimen will be called as cranium. Okay, let's see the parts of the skull. The two parts of the skull, one is the cranial skeleton and another is facial skeleton. Cranial skeleton is also referred to as neurocranium. Facial skeleton is also referred to as viscerocranium. So in the image we can roughly get an idea which part is cranial skeleton, which part is facial skeleton. Okay, so this yellow colored area is the facial skeleton and the remaining is the cranial skeleton. The subsequent slides will see which all bones are included in which part of the skeleton. So here we can see cranial skeleton consists of 8 bones, out of which paired bones are parietal bones and temporal bones. This is the parietal bone, this is the temporal bone. Okay, and unpaired bones include frontal bone, occipital bone, sphenoid and ethmoid. And the remaining bones are in the facial bones. They are 14 in number. Here also there are paired and unpaired bones. Unpaired bones include mandible and the vomer. And paired bones are maxilla. This is the maxilla bone. Then zygomatic bone, nasal bone, lacrimal bone. Then there is palatine and inferior nasal concha. Okay, in the lateral wall of the nose, the inferior nasal concha is a separate bone. And superior and middle nasal concha, these two are parts of the ethmoid bone. Okay, and apart from this, the ear ossicles are considered separately. Okay, those are present in the middle ear, 3 in each side. So this was about the bones forming the skull. Now let's learn about the exterior of the skull. The exterior of the skull is studied in the form of view. When the skull is viewed from the superior aspect, it is referred to as norma verticalis. So in my previous sessions, I taught you how to describe any view. First, we have to speak about the bones which are visible and the sutures visible in that view. Then any special features with respect to that view. And lastly, the applied anatomy related to that view. Okay. So in norma verticalis, which bones are visible? Here we can see this is the frontal bone. And these two are the parietal bones. And some part of occipital bone is also seen. Okay. These bones are visible in norma verticalis. Sutures visible are, this is the coronal suture between frontal bone and two parietal bones, and this is the sagittal suture between two parietal bones, and this is the lambdoid suture between two parietal bones and the occipital bone, and there may be metopic suture. What is metopic suture? It may be present in between the two halves of the frontal bone. Okay. These are the various sutures visible in norma verticalis. And various special features with respect to this view include One is Bregma. What is Bregma? It is the point of meeting of the coronal suture and the sagittal suture. This point is referred to as Bregma. Then what is vertex? Vertex is the highest point on the skull, okay, on the sagittal suture. Then parietal eminence or parietal tuber, the elevations on the parietal bone, convex elevations are referred to as parietal eminence or parietal tuber. Then parietal foramina, there is a small foramen just adjacent to the sagittal suture that is referred to as parietal foramina. Those transmit the emissary veins. And what is Obelion? It is the point on the sagittal suture in between the two parietal foramina. Okay? So these are various special features with respect to norma verticalis. Then applied anatomy related to this view. This Bregma has got a great clinical significance. This is the region of anterior fontanelle in fetal skull. This fuses at the age of around 18 to 24 months. Okay? Then before its fusion, it is important clinically because if there is bulging of the anterior fontanelle, that means there could be hydrocephalus. And if there is depression of the anterior fontanelle, it means it could be dehydration. Okay? And also some drugs can be injected through the anterior fontanelle directly into the superior sagittal sinus. So this was about norma verticalis. Now we'll move on to the other view. So let's study about the norma occipitalis. So skull viewed from the posterior aspect is referred to as norma occipitalis. Bones which are visible in this view are parietal bone. These two are the parietal bones, and this is the occipital bone. And here this is the mastoid process that is referred to as the mastoid part of the temporal bone. Okay, these bones are visible in norma occipitalis. And sutures visible are, there is a lambdoid suture. This suture is the lambdoid suture between parietal bone and the occipital bone. Then occipitomastoid suture between occipital bone and the mastoid part of the temporal bone. There is a suture which is referred to as occipitomastoid suture. Between parietal bone and mastoid bone, there is parietomastoid suture. Okay. In this image, the sutures are not visible clearly. You all can refer my previous 3D sessions to understand these sutures more clearly. Okay. Then various special features with respect to this view is, this point is referred to as lambda, the point of meeting of the sagittal suture and the lambdoid suture. This point is lambda. It is the region of the posterior fontanelle of the skull. Okay. Then external occipital protuberance. It is the most projecting point on the occipital bone. Okay. There is an elevation which is referred to as external occipital protuberance. The most prominent point on the external occipital protuberance is referred to as inion. Then external occipital crest. It extends from the external occipital protuberance up to the foramen magnum. Okay. There is a ridge which extends from external occipital protuberance to the foramen magnum, that is external occipital crest. Then mastoid foramen, these are small foramen in the mastoid part of the temporal bone. Superior nuchal line, inferior nuchal line, and highest nuchal line. These three are the nuchal lines which are described in norma occipitalis. Just adjacent to the external occipital protuberance, the lines is superior nuchal line. Midway between the superior nuchal line and the foramen magnum, there is inferior nuchal line. And 1 centimeter above the superior nuchal line is the highest nuchal line. Okay. Then applied anatomy related to norma occipitalis. The point which we mentioned in the external occipital protuberance, inion, this point is used for craniometry, for measuring the various dimensions of the skull. Then there could be sutural bones, also referred to as Vermian bones, also called as Inca bones. At times there may be bones in between the sutures that are referred to as sutural bones. Then attachment of galea aponeurotica. It gets attached onto the highest nuchal line. At times highest nuchal line is absent, So in that case, that will it will be attached onto the superior nuchal line. And attachments of trapezius and sternocleidomastoid, those are also present in the superior nuchal line. Medial aspect will give attachment to the trapezius, lateral aspect will give attachment to the sternocleidomastoid muscle. This was about norma occipitalis. Now let's learn about norma lateralis. Again, following our same headings, the bones visible, sutures visible, special features and applied aspect. So which are the bones visible in norma lateralis? The frontal bone, this is the frontal bone, this is the parietal bone, and on the posterior aspect, occipital bone, and this is the temporal bone, then sphenoid bone, here this we can see this is the greater wing of the sphenoid bone, then zygomatic bone, this is the zygomatic bone, and mandible, this is the mandible, and maxilla, this is maxilla, nasal bone, and lacrimal bone. Okay, so all these bones are seen in norma lateralis. Sutures visible in this view are lambdoid suture, the suture which we saw in norma occipitalis, some part is seen. Then coronal suture, here we can see this is the coronal suture, parietosquamous suture, between parietal bone and this is referred to as the squamous part of the temporal bone, that's why the suture is referred to as parietosquamous suture. Okay, then there are a few other sutures. The suture here is zygomatico-temporal suture. Then here this suture is seen, this is referred to as the frontozygomatic suture. Okay, then various special features with respect to norma lateralis. Pterion, what is pterion? It is an H-shaped suture where four bones meet. So which are those four bones? This is the frontal bone, parietal bone, the temporal bone, and the greater wing of the sphenoid bone. Okay, all these points, all these bones are meeting here in the region. This is referred to as pterion. There's a point on the posterior aspect which is referred to as asterion. Here three bones meet. One is the parietal bone, this is the temporal bone, and there is occipital bone. Okay. Then there is temporal line. There are two temporal lines, superior and the inferior temporal line. The superior temporal line fades away. The inferior temporal line continues here. This region is referred to as the supramastoid crest. Okay. There's a triangular region here which is described. This is referred to as McEwen's triangle. The boundaries are the supramastoid crest, the posterior superior margin of the external acoustic meatus, and a tangent drawn along the posterior margin of this external acoustic meatus. This triangular region is used to approach the mastoid antrum for surgeries of the mastoid abscess. Okay. Then external acoustic meatus we saw. Mastoid process, this is the mastoid process. One thing important about mastoid process is it is absent at birth. It is developed due to the pull of the sternocleidomastoid muscle. Okay. And here we can see this is the styloid process. Styloid process is also a part of temporal bone. Then infratemporal fossa. What is infratemporal fossa? The part here below the or we can see inner aspect of the zygomatic arch and the ramus of the mandible is infratemporal fossa. Above the zygomatic arch, whatever space is seen, that is referred to as temporal fossa. Okay, this is temporal fossa. Then applied aspects with respect to the norma lateralis. Since there are four bones meeting here, this is a common site of fracture in the skull, and if it gets fractured, it leads to rupture of a blood vessel which is just beneath it, as the anterior division of the middle meningeal artery, and when it ruptures, it leads to a clinical condition which is referred to as extradural hematoma. Okay. Then McEwen's triangle is for mastoid surgery. In the temporal fossa, there is a muscle which is referred to as temporalis, and the fascia which covers it is referred to as the temporalis fascia. That fascia is used for grafts of the ear. The tympanic membrane graft are usually taken from the temporal fascia. Okay. This was about norma lateralis. Now we'll study about the norma frontalis. So skull viewed from the anterior aspect is referred to as norma frontalis. Which are the bones visible in this view? Here's the frontal bone, and here there is nasal bone. And this is maxilla on each side. And this is zygomatic bone. This is mandible. So all these bones are visible in norma frontalis. The few bones in the orbit as well, which are visible. Sutures visible in norma frontalis are frontonasal suture. Between the frontal bone and the nasal bone, the suture is referred to as frontonasal suture. In between the two nasal bones, the suture is referred to as internasal suture. Then frontomaxillary suture. Between the frontal bone and the maxilla, there is a suture which is referred to as frontomaxillary suture. In zygomaticomaxillary suture, between zygomatic bone and maxilla. Okay, all these sutures are visible in norma frontalis. Also, there will be intermaxillary suture here in the midline. Okay, then special features in this view are nasion is a point where the frontonasal suture meets with the internasal suture. Okay, that point is referred to as nasion. Then glabella is the point where the two superciliary arches meet. Just above the orbit, the elevation of bone is referred to as superciliary arch. Okay. The point of meeting of the two superciliary arches is referred to as glabella. Then nathion, what is nathion? This elevation in the midline is referred to as mental protuberance. The most prominent point here along the lower border of the mandible is referred to as nathion. Then what is acanthion? This nasal aperture has got a sharp projection in the lower aspect that is referred to as acanthion. The anterior nasal spine is referred to as acanthion. Mental protuberance we have covered. Then various foramens which are seen in norma frontalis. Above the orbital opening, there is a small opening which is referred to as supraorbital foramen. And below it there is infraorbital foramen. And on the mandible there is mental foramen. Okay, these three foramens lie in one line. And applied aspects with respect to norma frontalis include, the most common bone to be fractured in face is this, the nasal bone. Okay, and fractures of the facial bones, other facial bones are also common. Those are referred to as Lefort fracture. In details I described in the actual 3D sessions. Okay, you all can go through it. Then there are age-related changes with respect to the mental foramen. This mental foramen is at the lower aspect in children. It's in the intermediate part in adults, and it moves higher up in old age. Okay. So this was about norma frontalis. Now we'll see about the norma basalis. The skull viewed from the inferior aspect is referred to as norma basalis. Okay. Students usually consider this norma basalis as the most tough part in the skull, but it's not that tough if we logically try to remember. Basalis is also simple. Okay. In norma basalis, in general, it is divided into three regions: the anterior part, intermediate part, and posterior part. Anterior part is up to this posterior margin of this palate, hard palate. Intermediate part is from this point to the anterior margin of the foramen magnum, and whatever is behind is referred to as the posterior part. So what all things are seen in the anterior part of norma basalis? The teeth are removed here. We'll see the alveolar sockets. Okay, alveolar processes will be seen in the maxilla. Then hard palate is formed by two bones. The anterior 3/4 part is formed by the maxilla. The posterior 1/4 part is formed by the palatine bone. Okay. This part is referred to as the horizontal plate of the maxilla, and here this will be referred to as the horizontal plate of the palatine bone. And there are sutures here. In between the two maxillary bones, there is intermaxillary suture. And in between the two palatine bones, there is interpalatine suture. And in between the maxillary bone and palatine bone, there is palatomaxillary suture. Okay, and we can see a small opening here, just behind the incisor tooth. So this is the incisive fossa. Then along the lateral aspect of this palatine bone, there are two small openings. This referred to as the greater palatine foramen and lesser palatine foramen. Okay. So all these are the important things with respect to the anterior part of the norma basalis. Students usually get confused in the intermediate part of norma basalis because there are multiple openings which are seen in this intermediate part. We'll try to simplify it. First, let's try to identify the bones which are seen in this intermediate part. This part is the sphenoid bone. And here, this is the posterior aspect of the vomer bone. And these are the posterior nasal openings. Those are referred to as choanae. Okay? Then, this is the part of the sphenoid bone itself, the lateral pterygoid plate, the medial pterygoid plate. And in between the two pterygoid plates, there's a depression which is referred to as pterygoid fossa. And here there is the part of the temporal bone. So sphenoid bone and temporal bone, they form majority of this intermediate part. Now let's see the openings which are seen in this intermediate part. Just adjacent to the sphenoid bone, this opening which is seen, this is the foramen lacerum. Then in the sphenoid bone, certain openings are seen. This oval opening is referred to as foramen ovale. And there's a small opening behind foramen ovale, that is foramen spinosum. And this opening, which we can see, this is the carotid canal. And between the styloid process and the mastoid process, there's an opening which is referred to as the stylomastoid foramen. So in the intermediate part, if we know at least these openings, it will be sufficient. I'll repeat again. The foramen lacerum, foramen ovale, foramen spinosum, carotid canal, and the stylomastoid foramen. If you at least know these openings and what structures pass through these openings, will be sufficient for norma basalis. Okay. And in the posterior part of norma basalis, this large opening which we can see, this is the foramen magnum. And there are projections just adjacent to the foramen magnum. These are referred to as occipital condyles. Then in the temporal bone, there's a depression which is referred to as mandibular fossa, which accommodates the head of the mandible. Okay? This is the mastoid process. And certain parts of the norma occipitalis is also seen in norma basalis. The external occipital protuberance, the external occipital crest, okay, those parts are also seen in norma basalis. Now we'll study about the cranial cavity. So here this is a specimen of cranial cavity. So to study the cranial cavity, the calvary has been cut open to expose the interior of the skull. Cranial cavity is also studied in three parts. This anterior part is referred to as the anterior cranial fossa. Intermediate part is the middle cranial fossa. And the part behind is the posterior cranial fossa. Okay. These three cranial fossa are arranged stepwise. The anterior cranial fossa is at a higher level. The middle cranial fossa is at the intermediate level. Posterior cranial fossa is at the lowest level. Okay. What all structures are seen in anterior cranial fossa? This is the orbital plate of the frontal bone. And on the inner aspect of the frontal bone, there's a elevation which is referred to as the frontal crest. And there's a projection here which is referred to as crista galli. Then adjacent to this crista galli, there is cribriform plate of the ethmoid bone. Okay, which transmit multiple olfactory rootlets. Then this region is the lesser wing of the sphenoid bone. So three bones seen in the anterior cranial fossa are frontal bone, ethmoid bone, and the lesser wing of the sphenoid bone. And here we can see this region is the middle cranial fossa. The central part is formed by the body of the sphenoid bone. The lateral part, it includes the greater wing of the sphenoid as well as the temporal bones. Okay, what all structures are seen in this middle part? This projection here of the lesser wing of the sphenoid is the anterior clinoid process. Similarly, there is one on the posterior aspect that is referred to as posterior clinoid process. This projection here is referred to as the dorsum cellae. Okay. And this concave depression here is referred to as hypophyseal fossa, also referred to as cella tertica. Then in the middle cranial fossa also there are multiple openings. This adjacent to the body of the sphenoid, this opening is the foramen lacerum. This oval opening is foramen ovale. Just behind the foramen ovale, there is foramen spinosum. Okay. And anteriorly, there are two openings here. One is the superior orbital fissure and foramen rotundum. Okay, there are four openings which lie in one arc: the superior orbital fissure, foramen rotundum, foramen ovale, and foramen spinosum. And let's see the posterior part of the cranial cavity. This is posterior cranial fossa. This part of the bone is referred to as the petrous part of the temporal bone. There's an opening on the inner aspect of the petrous part of temporal bone, that is internal acoustic meatus. Then here there's an opening which is referred to as jugular foramen. This opening is foramen magnum. There's a small opening seen just anterolateral to this foramen magnum, that is anterior condylar canal, also referred to as hypoglossal canal. Then on the inner aspect of the occipital bone, there are certain features. This projection here is the internal occipital protuberance. Just like on the outer aspect, there is external occipital protuberance. On the inner aspect, there is internal occipital protuberance. Okay. And this crest is referred to as the internal occipital crest. And here we can see there are grooves for the transverse sinus, sigmoid sinus. The superior sagittal sinus continues as the right transverse sinus, which can be appreciated here. And right transverse sinus will continue as the sigmoid sinus, which will go up to the jugular foramen. So we have revised the skull with all the foramen in detail. Now I'll add on slides which will cover the various structures passing through this foramen. Now let's start with the mandible bone. Mandible is the bone of the lower jaw. Parts of the mandible. This part is referred to as the body of the mandible, and this is the ramus of the mandible on each side. Okay. The body of the mandible has got a superior border, an inferior border, an outer surface, and an inner surface. The ramus of the mandible has got four borders: anterior border, posterior border, superior border, inferior border. And the two surfaces are the outer surface and the inner surface. Then various muscle attachments with respect to the mandible. On the outer aspect of the ramus of the mandible, the muscle is masseter muscle. On the oblique line, there is a muscle which is referred to as buccinator. And there are some muscles of the face which are attached here. And there are various muscles on the inner aspect of the mandible. This mandible is cut such that the left half of the mandible is viewed from the inner aspect. There's a muscle here along the angle of the mandible on the inner aspect, that is the medial pterygoid muscle. Just below the head of the mandible, there is a small depression referred to as pterygoid fovea. The muscle attached is lateral pterygoid muscle. And this line is referred to as the mylohyoid line, which gives attachment to the mylohyoid muscle. Okay. And this projection here, this is the coronoid process, which gives attachment to a muscle that is temporalis muscle. That these two projections are important in mandible. This is the head, also referred to as the condylar process, and this is the coronoid process. And in between them, this notch is referred to as mandibular notch. And this opening, which we can see, this is the mandibular foramen. Just anterior to the mandibular foramen, there is a projection, is referred to as the lingula of the mandible. And above the mylohyoid line, the depression here is referred to as the sublingual fossa. Below the mylohyoid line, the depression is submandibular fossa. In the midline on the posterior aspect, there are four genial tubercles, two superior and two inferior. These genial tubercles are also referred to as mental spines. Various ligaments attached to the mandible. There is stylomandibular ligament, gets attached along the angle of the mandible, then lateral temporomandibular ligament, and there's a pterygomandibular ligament, also referred to as pterygomandibular raphe, and there's a ligament which is attached along the lingula of the mandible, that is referred to as the spinomandibular ligament. Okay, these are the four ligaments attached onto the mandible. Then there are various nerves related to the mandible. On the inner aspect, if we see, this opening transmits the nerve, that is the inferior alveolar nerve. Okay, it passes through the mandibular foramen. Inferior alveolar nerve gives a branch which passes through this region. This is referred to as the mylohyoid groove. The nerve here is nerve to mylohyoid. Okay, so inferior alveolar nerve, nerve to mylohyoid. And there's a nerve near the neck of the mandible which is referred to as the auriculotemporal nerve. Then near the third molar tooth, there is a nerve which is lingual nerve. Okay. These nerves are seen along the inner aspect of the mandible. And on the outer aspect of the mandible, there is a nerve which exits out through this mandibular notch to supply the masseter muscle, that is the masseteric nerve. Then through the mental foramen, a nerve exits, that is the mental nerve. And a nerve related along the inferior margin of the body of the mandible, that is marginal mandibular nerve. Okay, so in all there are seven nerves related to the mandible. And joints formed by the mandible, the head of the mandible, it will articulate with the temporal bone. There is mandibular fossa which we saw in norma basalis. This articulation is the temporomandibular joint. The two halves of the mandible are connected in the midline by a symphyseal joint that is referred to as the symphysis menti. Its name is symphysis, but the joint actually behaves like a primary cartilaginous joint. Okay, both halves of the mandible are fused. Then various applied anatomy with respect to the mandible. One applied anatomy we covered in norma frontalis, that is the age-related changes of the mental foramen. Then mandible is prone to fracture. This neck of the mandible is the commonest site for fracture of the mandible. Then this inferior alveolar nerve, which passes through this mandibular foramen. In dental procedures, this nerve has to be blocked. So for that, the lingula has to be palpated and the anesthetic agent is injected just behind the lingula of the mandible. These were certain applied aspects with respect to the mandible. Now we'll cover the cervical vertebrae. Cervical vertebrae, as you can see, this is the cranial most part of the vertebral column. And just note the curvatures of the vertebral column. This cervical curvature is convex on the anterior aspect. So here it is magnified here. Cervical curvature is an example of a secondary curvature. Okay, starts to develop at the age of 3 months when the baby starts holding the neck. Seven cervical vertebrae, they are divided into typical and atypical. 3, 4, 5, 6 are typical. First, second, and seventh, these are atypical cervical vertebrae. Okay, Here we can see this is the typical cervical vertebrae. What are the features which we can appreciate? The most important feature is this. This opening is the foramen transversarium. If this opening is present, that means it is cervical vertebrae. It is the cardinal feature of the cervical vertebrae. Then we can see the body is more broad from side to side. It is small from anteroposterior aspect. If we compare the body with this opening, this is the vertebral foramen. Vertebral foramen is larger as compared to that of the body of the vertebrae. Okay. In general, when we describe the vertebrae, we describe the vertebrae under two headings. One is the body and the remaining part is referred to as the vertebral arch. What all components are included in vertebral arch? This transverse process, pedicle, the articular process, lamina, and the spinous process. All these are the components in the vertebral arch. That is characteristic feature with respect to the transverse process of cervical vertebrae. Because of this opening, the various parts which are described in the transverse process, this part is referred to as the anterior root. The part behind is the posterior root. Projection here is the anterior tubercle. Projection here is the posterior tubercle. And in connecting the two tubercles, there is costo-transverse bar. Okay, various components in the transverse process. Then on the upper part of the pedicle, there is a notch which is referred to as superior vertebral notch. Superior vertebral notch is deeper as compared to that of the inferior vertebral notch for cervical vertebrae. Then the spinous process is bifid. Okay, we can see the splitting of the spinous process. This gap is occupied by a ligament which is referred to as ligamentum nucae. So these are various features of a typical cervical vertebrae. Let's see the features of the atypical cervical vertebrae. Here we can see two atypical cervical vertebrae. One is atlas and other is axis. Atlas is a ring-like vertebrae. It doesn't have body. Okay, its body has been migrated to the second cervical vertebrae, which is represented by the odontoid process or the dents of the axis. So for atlas vertebrae, at times it becomes difficult to identify like which part is superior, which part is inferior, which part is anterior, which part is posterior. So for that, what we can do, you can see the superior aspect. This concave depression, the superior articular facet, it is concave for articulation with the occipital condyles. It is an ellipsoid variety of synovial joint. Okay, and the inferior articular facets, if we see, those will be circular. This part is referred to as the anterior arch of the atlas. This part is referred to as the posterior arch of the atlas. In this ring, the anterior arch forms the 1/3 and posterior arch forms the 2/3 of the ring. Okay, that's how we can identify which is anterior and which is posterior. Then for axis vertebrae, the most characteristic identification feature is the odontoid process or the dents. And it has a very broad spinous process as compared to that of other cervical vertebrae. And the seventh cervical vertebrae, how to differentiate it from the typical ones? You can see a long spinous process. This is the longest among all the spinous process, which is referred to as vertebra prominence. And this will resemble that of the first thoracic vertebrae. So how to differentiate C7 from T1? C7 usually will have this foramen transversarium and T1 will have costal facets. Okay, costal facet is the cardinal feature for thoracic vertebrae. So this was about all cervical vertebrae. And various applied aspects with respect to the cervical vertebrae include this. There is one applied aspect with respect to the anterior tubercle of the sixth cervical vertebrae, which is referred to as Cassegnax tubercle. It is the largest amongst all the anterior tubercles, and the common carotid artery is usually palpated against it, and that's why it is also referred to as carotid tubercle. Okay, then this atlas may fuse with the occipital condyles. That clinical condition is referred to as occipitalization of the atlas. Then there may be cervical disc prolapse. The in between the two vertebrae there is intervertebral disc which may prolapse and then compress upon the nerve roots which are exiting. that is referred to as cervical disc prolapse. Then there may be fusion of the cervical vertebrae in a clinical condition called as Klippel-Feil syndrome. This was all about cervical vertebrae. Now let's cover the hyoid bone. Hyoid bone is the only bone in the body which doesn't articulate with any other bone. It is usually suspended by the stylohyoid ligament. Okay, various parts of the hyoid bone are, this is the body of the hyoid bone. This projection is the lesser corneum of the hyoid bone, and this is the greater corneum of the hyoid bone. What is the vertebral level of hyoid bone? It is C3 vertebra. Okay, and development of hyoid bone is very important. You should be knowing the upper half of the body and the lesser corneum are these are derived from the second pharyngeal arch, and the lower half of the body and the greater corneum, they are derived from the third pharyngeal arch. Here we can see the lateral view of the hyoid bone. This is lesser cornua, greater cornua, and body. There's one important applied anatomy with respect to the greater cornua of the hyoid bone. The three anterior branches of external carotid artery, we should be knowing the relations with respect to the greater cornua. The facial artery is above the greater cornua of hyoid bone. Lingual artery is at the level of greater cornua of hyoid bone. And the superior thyroid artery is at a lower level with respect to the greater cornua of the hyoid bone. Okay. And there is one medico-legal importance with respect to the hyoid bone. If the hyoid bone is fractured, it suggests that the death may be due to throttling or strangulation. Because when the death is due to hanging, hyoid bone usually doesn't get fractured. Okay. This is the last part of this session. The ossicles of the ear. This is the malleus, this is incus, and this is stapes. Various parts of this ossicles also we should be knowing. This is the head of the malleus. Below the head there is the neck of the malleus. This is anterior process, this lateral process, and this is the handle of the malleus. Okay. And for incus, this is the body of the incus. This is the short process of incus. This is the long process of the incus, which gives a projection in the lower aspect that is referred to as the lenticular process. And for stapes, this is the head of the stapes, and there is anterior arch, posterior arch, and foot plate. And the articulation between these three ossicles are also important. Between malleus and incus, the joint is incudomalleolar joint. It is a saddle variety of synovial joint. And the joint between incus and stapes, this is a ball and socket variety of synovial joint. Okay, so all ossicles are present in the middle ear. Development of these ossicles are also important. The malleus and the incus, they develop from the first pharyngeal arch. The stapes, it develops from the second pharyngeal arch, except the foot plate. Okay, foot plate arises from the otic capsule. Then the muscles attached to the ossicles, we should be knowing. Malleus gives attachment to a muscle that is tensor tympani muscle, and stapes gives attachment to a muscle that is stapedius. Okay. So this was about the ossicles of the ear. So we have covered all bones in the head and neck region. Okay. So if you all have any doubts, you all can ask in the comments section below. Okay. Thank you. Thank you.